Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture number 6 on the day 3 afternoon or second session of the Fishery Oceanography for Future Professionals course. In this particular lecture, first we will blast off, or I would say for the Star Trek fans out there, beam up to the space to talk about satellite telemetry for the fisheries applications. Then we come down from global to molecular scale and talk about environmental DNA applications or surveys, and then its applications for the fisheries. So I hope you would like to know more about that, and some instruction for the logistics. You can also pose or post your questions in the live chat while the lecture is on. So my team members are already noting down them, and they will compile for me. So when I finish the lecture, there will be already questions that I can start answering right away. I hope you will enjoy something new that you will learn today. So first, we will talk about satellite telemetry. Telemetry is different, there are different types of them. And acoustic telemetry we covered a little bit today under acoustic class. And other type of telemetry is the satellite telemetry. So this includes two questions: how satellite telemetry works, and why scientists or fishery oceanographer would like to do those kind of experiments. So first of all, just to give the overview, that basically it is about that one can attach to a species of interest to study. Here the example could be of a bird or a turtle or a seal or a polar bear, as you can see in the example. Any species, either it is on land, it is a bird that spends a lot of time in the air, or a fish or a mammal that spends a lot of time in the water. And ultimately, the transmissions from the animal movement and the data it is collected on the same time, it will be transmitted to the satellite, and satellite will give this kind of data or retransmit back to a particular server. So just like we receive an email, similar to that, those messages will come into our accounts. And there, then scientists can download and analyze the data to study the behavior, the movement, the environmental preference of an animal in interest. So what kind of satellites support these studies? So there is the Argos constellation that provides a basic location fix. So Argos location fix is not as accurate or precise like GPS, but in terms of battery and in terms of data packets, it is very, very small. So it is very much suitable for the small transmitters that we attach to the animals. And Argos is also a constellation of a dedicated channel for transmission of these kind of data packets. So there are some delays in some of the launches. For example, OceanSat 3 was supposed to launch late in 2019. It was delayed because of a few unavoidable reasons to 2020. And because of the COVID-19 now, it is pushed back to 2021. Rest of the satellites are already in place, and the Canes Angels satellite, one of that also, it is already launched. So that is an array of nano satellites. So that also will be like operational by additioning of the more satellites. And ultimately, the support, basically as of now, major support is coming from EUMETSAT. So that is from European Union. And that is already committed till 2036. And other countries are also joining, like India and other countries. NOAA satellites are also supporting the transponders. So basically, in foreseeable future, when as a fishery oceanographer, you need to rely on such technology, there will be abundant support that will be available. So that promises the at least near to midterm future of this kind of experiments. Now, further talking back about Argos, how the satellite wise will go. So upper left corner, there is a network that is shown along with the each ground station radio horizons. So you can see that almost no part of the Earth's surface it is left without where satellite is above head, and then there is no ground station beneath to receive the data. So that is one of the support at ground level support it is there. And because of that, you can see on the upper right corner image that kind of platforms, thousands of platforms, it is actually supporting simultaneously. So this image where it says that 8,000 plus animals tracked last month, it is about late 2018 image, and the numbers have increased after that many more. And the recent years, the growth of the platform numbers, it is exponential because affordable technology and miniaturization of the electronics. So here the different color schemes are there, and then you can see that the yellow one, it is about the platforms that is installed on birds. So you can see the yellow dots on land as well as in the ocean. You can see some purple color dots in the ocean, which represents marine animals. There are some pink color dots on land that represents land animals, and very few, you will notice blue dots are also there. That represents the platforms put on the fishes. So as a fishery oceanographer or a fishery scientist, you would be surprised to see that it is not that proficiently used when it comes to for the fisheries. So same statistics you can also see from the pie chart below. And you can see that even though the usage for the marine animals, it is very abundant for fishes, either it is in the lakes or rivers or in the ocean, that proportion is very, very less. I'll come to that, why that is the reason. I'll come to that in the upcoming slides. Before that, you can notice lower left that image where you can see the transmissions happening. So the diagonally upper corner, it was the platforms themselves, one transmission. But the heat map, it is about a number of transmissions that is being reported from a particular place. And that heat map tells us also about the migratory behavior. For example, you have studied about the upwelling zones. You try to notice this particular, you try to correlate this image with the presence of upwelling zones in your mind. You can see a lot of movement of the animals or other platforms along the upwelling zones. For example, of Peru, of Central America, in Pacific. So that you can see that upwelling zone, it is well lit, if we can say. Same is for the Amazonia or the migration that happens in the sub-Saharan region. So this is how the collection of the data points also tell us the migratory behavior of the animals which are tagged with this kind of satellite tags. Now before we move to the fish part, as I promised, I will just give one example for the a bird tracking. And you can see here that since bird will always be there, either perching on the tree or flying in the air, it is as good as your smartphone, it is connected to the GPS. And that's why you can get very nice tracks like this, because it will always get the GPS fix, and which are very precise ones, often within a few meters, so that you can actually pinpoint the migration route. And that is the reason that you can avoid putting heavy sensors for any other reasons, and bird will not be feeling any fatigue during the track. What happens when we put this kind of tags, or what kind of tags are there for the fishes? So these are the examples that is for the marine applications basically. So there are these conventional plastic tags which were used abundantly in earlier years. So for example, in last century, putting plastic tag and then relying that fish will get caught and somebody will report that with this unique number, that was the major technology that was being used because of the cost effectiveness. But with the increasing concerns for the plastic pollution and the number of very low turnout, because you have to put thousands of the tags and then you may get hardly few hundred back. So the ratio of turnout of the tags, it is very, very low. It is also fishery dependent, and it does not tell basically what happened in between. So you know where you caught the fish. It is similar basically like a bird ringing program. So you can think in terms of like how much bird ringing program can tell, and a satellite transmitter, if you put on bird, it will tell you much more. Similarly here also, where the fish has been released with tag and where it was caught, if somebody reports that, those two points only you will come to know. Nevertheless, it has its own importance, and it has been used to map the population boundaries, and for that it is useful. Archival tag is a smarter version of that. So basically it is everything same, but only difference is that it will also collect some data en route. So it will not be able to tell you the locations and everything, but it will tell that as the season progressed, for example, what temperature of waters that fish was swimming, what was the fishing depth for each of these months, and that kind of, if you are lucky, you can get that tag back, then you can plug in that tag to your computer, and then you can download the data to analyze. Again, it is fishery dependent, so there is a limitation on how much you get back, especially with the electronics, undamaged tags where you can download the data. Acoustic tags we covered yesterday, so I'm not going to cover again. Satellite tags, two examples are there. So down it is a PSAT, pop-up satellite archival tag, which mainly used for the fishes. There the tag after the mission life, it will detach from the fish and it will come to the surface, because then only it will be able to communicate with the satellite. There is other kind of satellite tag that is shown above, that is used for the other kind of animals. For example, seals or turtles or whales, which have tendency to surface. So that will not pop up, but ultimately whenever the animal surfaces, that time it will take the opportunity to transmit the data, so data packets. So this way you will not get real-time tracking underwater, because there is no GPS signal underwater, but you can still get very frequent data in compared to when you are tracking the fish. Because when you are tracking the fish, hardly it will surface, and at the end of the mission life, which might be sometimes after a few weeks or sometimes after a few months or even a year, after that only you get all the data to download. So this is how the pop-up satellite archival tag works, and due to its intricacies in the design, I'll just go through a little bit about the different parts of that. So you can see there is an antenna that need to be out of the water in order to communicate. Then there is a float. So float will actually bring us tag to the surface after the detachment. All the other sensors are kept below that, so that center of gravity will keep the tag upright and antenna out of the water. What kind of sensors? So in the tag body, you can see that there is a light sensor. Within the tag body, there is a depth sensor, temperature sensor. All are inbuilt. So wherever fish is moving, it will collect all the data. And how do we connect this kind of tag to the fish? So that there is this kind of tethering mechanism is there, comprising from the serial number 5 to 9. So ultimately at the end, like the 9 number, where the tether, it could be umbrella kind of a tether, or it could be conventional that V-shaped tether. So that tether will attach the tag to the fish body. So these kind of tags, unlike the acoustic tag that I described and shown yesterday, these are not the injectable ones. So you don't put this inside the fish body, but it will be dangling out, and fish will take or trail, it will trail with the fish wherever the fish goes, and then ultimately it will collect the data. The tag design is made in that way that it has the best possible hydrodynamics, so that it will not give any drag to the fish natural movement, so that you can ensure as a researcher that the behavior of the fish that you are analyzing from your data, that is close to the natural one. It is not the because of tag now fish is behaving unusually. So this is where you can actually optimally put the tag. So here the example is shown of the sailfish in diagram, and in photograph it is for the yellowfin tuna. So basically this is the place where you attach the tag, and if you have the question, if fish gets any injury or anything, I would like to compare this process more like a ear piercing process. So if you hit the right spot, there will be no blood capillaries, so there is a little or no blood loss, very minute pain, and most of the cases fish stays very calm. You can also see that fish in the photograph, that fish eyes are covered. That is also adding to the particular calmness of the fish, because as long as it does not see the humans, it will not get panic. And when we tag, we actually also put running seawater hose inside the fish mouth, because when you are taking it out of the water, you need to keep the gills irrigated. And this whole process, usually it is finished within 60 seconds or less than that. So you bring the fish very gently without pulling from the hook where it has taken the bite, and then you remove the hook so that the jaw is not damaged. Whatever the injured parts are there, whether it is from the hook or because of the tag, that puncture that you made, you also apply some antibiotic, and then you put this tag and release the fish without splashing. So gently you can release the fish, and most time we have seen that it will swim to get the reorient itself, and then it will swim away because it has experienced something unusual. So definitely it need to be away from that particular location. So that is the first instinct. So that is how the tag it attached to the fish body. And you might have noticed that there is a light sensor in that. So underwater there is no GPS signal, like I said, but light is used to estimate the latitude and longitude. So these schematics show the idea. Right now in the northern hemisphere it is winter, just like the image it is shown. So the day length will be shorter than in compared to the southern hemisphere. Now the tag has the light sensor, which will basically notice the sunrise and sunset time, because you have prolonged darkness after the sunset, and then after sunrise you start getting some light readings. So that is helped helping in the determining sunrise and sunset time and calculating the day length, how many hours the ambient light level. So this it is used for calculating the day length, and day length wise the latitude is estimated. Now the same day length, when it is divided by 2, then you get the local noon time. Why I say local noon time? Because when you release the fish, you don't know where it is migrating, so it may not be always the your local time. And that's the reason that the tag has internal clock that is set with the UTC. So now you need to just calculate the local noon that you have derived from the light sensor, and then check the offset in terms of with UTC noon time. So for example, if the fish is in the Atlantic, then the local noon will happen for the fish earlier than UTC. Other way around, if it is in the Indian Ocean, there will be like some time gap after which the local noon is recorded. So the time will be UTC plus some hours, and based on that you can determine whether it was off African coast or whether it was off Southeast Asian coast, because the offset from the UTC will be different in either cases. So that is how you determine the longitude. Having said that, definitely it is easier said than done, and sometimes you are very lucky, you get relatively very smooth tracks. Sometimes it is not, and you have to do a lot of work to smoothen out that. Why it happens is because the day length at some point of time in the year, and that is called equinox, it is same for the northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere. So when your tag is there on the fish and it is recording the data for say many months, it may encounter one or two equinoxes. At the same time, the data point that is being collected will be entirely in wrong hemisphere as well. So that is how you get these errors. Also another source of error is that fish tend to deep dive. So your light levels may not always be precise at the time of sunrise and sunset. So if fish is coming closer to the surface later than sunrise, you may get wrong reading. Because of that, you may estimate the latitude and longitude both wrong. But fortunately, there are mathematical ways to process this, and basically trying to recreate the track, which ultimately makes you start from the starting point where you tag the fish, the known location. End location is where the tag is surfacing, and now you start getting the near real-time locations, because now you start getting these messages. So the downloading data of the archival where it was on the fish, that also you start getting. At the same time, you also start getting relatively live positions, because when the track is drifting on the surface. So that will be your endpoint, and your goal is to meet this start point to end point in a logical manner. So why I should say logical manner? When you are tagging a marine animal, as you can see from the lower image, that many of the points are going on the land. That is not at all logical, right? But with the mathematical processing, you can actually derive the most probable track. It will always have some sort of uncertainty, but you can understand the basic migration route. And that is also a very much valuable information for any fishery scientist, which otherwise this kind of information was not available to them. So now there are some workarounds to work with these GPS locations. So I will not read all of these, like why GPS cannot be used. In essence, GPS takes time to get fixed from the GPS satellites. So you might have experienced this when you turn on your smartphone GPS. It takes some time to give your position immediately. So that time, that is called latency. And that takes time, that it will reorient itself and then try to start communicating with all the GPS satellite at the same time. What is the solution that can be there for some type of animals? That you know that, like how the satellites are going to move. So you can estimate the satellite positions, and then you can have these kind of data already inbuilt in the tag. And then you can also have the same thing in your server or processor. So basically, when you download the data, you only need to know that which unique number of the satellite, because each satellite have its own, GPS satellite has its own unique ID. So you will have to match their positions. So what basically this kind of workaround solution does, that it will take a snapshot, but it will only work for the surfacing animals. So for example, a turtle or a whale, it is surfacing. At the time, it will try to just take the snapshot of all the GPS satellites. So for example, satellite number 2, 34 and 76 is there seen, at which angle it is seen, and that snapshot only it will take. So which direction means like angle from the horizon, and that will be unique, because each satellite is moving in a unique way. So basically you need to then rematch that where these three satellites can be at this particular angle from the horizon at a given date and time. So that will give you the idea. So this kind of snapshotting happens in less than a second. So you can see here it happens within like even 150 milliseconds. And then the rest of the processing happens when the animal is again underwater, because that time you don't have to have the connection with the satellite. So that is another workaround solution. And after the processing, it captures all the data into smaller bytes that can be then transmitted via Argos with the lowest battery that is available in the transmitter. So this is the workaround solution that is helping for the better locations, at least for the surfacing animals. And what are the advantages of using satellite telemetry? So like the programs like tagging of Pacific predators, so TOP. Similar, like after that, the satellite telemetry is being used abundantly. So that shown for the first time how widespread use of these kind of tags can give many, many new insights in the movement of these kind of large animals. And definitely it is fishery independent. So there is a limitation on how much you can do with the fishery surveys. So this is also aware that the shoaling behavior fishes, you tag one of the specimen and then it will represent the whole group. So the movement of one fish will represent the whole group, and you don't have to understand that. This is least eating the animal. You are not taking it out of the water forever. It is only briefly, and then it will live normal and natural life until being predated or being fished. So these are the advantages. And why researchers go for the satellite telemetry? Everybody has their own, based on their programs and objectives, their own research interests. So it could be for reducing the bycatch or mortality or any accidental deaths due to shipping or other activities, or ecotourism point of view. You want to also, like yesterday I shown one example, you want to use these kind of animals as a biological platform for ocean observations. And that last thing I'll just show first. This is one example. Yesterday what I was talking about, the seal example, that in the Antarctic you can see the Weddell Sea area, and it will have like huge ice sheet beneath which you will never be able to get the data with any autonomous vehicles. But it is also very important for the researchers, so observation scientists and numerical modelers, to get the data, because without that, that cannot be assimilated and models will not be giving you correct predictions. What is happening beneath the ice sheet? How much warming is happening, and other biogeochemical processes which were covered in the some lectures yesterday. So those things, if you want to understand, here you can see that, and I would try to use the cursor. So if it is seen that this is the data before assimilating the whatever the numerical model output that was there, before assimilating the data that was collected from this seal. So you can see this seal, and then the tag, satellite tag on the collected all the data. So you can see that wherever it was collecting the data. And then this is without assimilating that temperature data that seal has collected. And this is now after assimilating that data. You can see that how much gap filling that has done, and how much improvement in the model output it has done. So this is also a very novel idea. And very often, because for example yesterday we coasting a lot to get the observations, you try to put autonomous observations like Argo floats or a glider, and that also has some costs. These tags are costing even fraction of that. So when you have the biological platforms, you can actually put the tags on them. It will not only give you the idea on the fish or the animal behavior or its movement or migration, but it also collects oceanographic data for you. So these are the double advantages. Some other purposes or the objectives that I mentioned. So already the ecotourism potential for whale shark locations has been already known, and this is one of the like candidate species for the conservation or for the ecotourism. And there are other species also that is same way, that when you know the tracks, when you know their environmental preferences, you know the seasonal behavior, their annual migration routes, and then you can actually give better estimation for which are the very potential ecotourism hotspots or pockets. Similar to that, when you want to go for the conservation or bycatch reduction, accidental mortality. So this is the example of bycatch. The fishermen who never intended to catch the turtles, but by the time they pull the net up and realize the turtles have been underwater submerged for a long time, and then due to could not surface and breathe, and they are already dead by the time. Another example is here the fishing boat that accidentally hit the propeller to the shell of the turtle, and then chances of mortality for such injured animals are more. So in these cases, what can be done is that whatever experiments that is done in Pacific, and then the movement of the turtles were tracked, it is understood their association with the oceanographic features like eddies, and then basically it gives the idea that which could be the most potential zones for the turtle migration. So which are the corridors for the turtle migration, and based on that, NOAA now gives this kind of a product called Turtle Watch. So that gives the idea for the fishermen. Here the shaded zone is the Turtle Watch zone. So it gives the idea to the fishermen that where to slow down the vessel, or where try to avoid the putting the net, so that they can avoid, you know, harming turtles unintentionally. Now, directly from the space, we have to climb down to the molecular scale. And then second part of this presentation or lecture, it is about the eDNA. Now, when you all read eDNA, now when we see this E term, like e-cigarettes or anything starts that with E, we tend to think that it is about electronics. But in this context, that meaning is a little bit different. So here, eDNA does not mean electronic DNA, but it does mean environmental DNA. So how environmental DNA has the applications to the fisheries, that we will just see here. Before jumping down to that, we need to see that within a cell, now so many types of science disciplines have been emerging. So there is a lot of material within a cell. As a biologist, you all must be knowing. So all types of DNA, whether it is in the nucleus or it's not in the nucleus, all combined it is called genome. And similarly, different kind of omes are there. Related to that, different science streams are emerging to study that, and those are called omics. So here, for example, the stream that studies the genome, it is called genomics, and so on and so forth. So I'll not read each of these, but just to give you the idea that what genomics is. You need to be introduced to this term, and also you need to be introduced to this particular, you need to remember the structure of DNA, because that is being used basically for all kind of genomic study. So we know that like this base pairing happening with AT and GC, and in RNA definitely this thymine will be like replaced with the uracil. So as biologist, this I believe that you are already aware about that. So just to remind you the basic structure of DNA, how this works for our purposes. So there are two different terms for that. Either it is like a barcoding and metabarcoding, or you can say genomics and metagenomics. So DNA barcoding, here it is called genomics, where you take a tissue sample of a known animal, and then you try to map its genome. Where you are doing it from a free floating or a mixed pool of the sample, it is called metagenomics, like in case of metabarcoding. So in upper example, for example, you are studying different kind of insects, and then you put different taste and smell of nectars, and then when you catch the particular specimen of this particular species, and then you extract the DNA separately, that is called genomics with the help of DNA barcoding. So for example, a fly, you can actually take its own genome and you can study that standalone. So standalone study will give more intact strand of the genes, and then the base pairs will be very long, and then you can study and map whole genome. When you are going for the meta scale of the same, you may not be that lucky, because this in the second example, for example, you have been putting this kind of nectars, but those are not very viscous enough, and then these flies and other insects are just visiting and then leaving some DNA traces in that, but maybe some tissues or some shedding of the other cells, so that you can get some DNA signature, but they will fly away, so you will not get the pure insect or species level DNA. It is a mixed pool of that. Now you need to do the PCR. In next slide I will show what is PCR, polymerase chain reaction, if you know, just for the revision purpose. And from that mixed pool, then you derive the separate smaller strand, because that will be a fraction of DNA, but with the particular unique locations in the genomes, you can still identify the species. So doing the reverse way, that you don't know the species, but with your library you are matching now the unique regions of the genome, and then you can say that, okay, how the fly is separate from the dragonfly. So if the fly has visited or dragonfly has visited. So as I said, revision of the polymerase chain reaction, why amplification is required, especially in the environmental DNA sample, because the bulk of the sample that you receive in metabarcoding, it is not that high, because you don't have the whole tissue or the species or specimen or organism to extract the full DNA. So whatever sample that you have, it is having in very minute amounts, it is very diluted, you can say, and then you have to go for the amplification. So here blue color is that the mother chain, and then green one is the progeny chain. So now the purple primers are attached to that, and then basically new strands are being made. This process is keep on repeating again and again till you get a sufficient bulk of the DNA strands, which then you can actually have some quantification for this study. So that is why polymerase chain reaction amplification it is being used. So when it comes for a fishery oceanographer, the study of or use of environmental DNA, this is how it is done. So uppercase is the DNA barcoding or the genomics, where you have the specimen itself. The free floating means like you have to collect the water sample, and then you can see what DNA is present there, and then ultimately you do the PCR amplification. If you are knowing the species beforehand, as in the uppercase, that is genomics, you need to then see that, okay, how the population are different. So for example, you know the genome, and then you know which species that you have in general that you have taken the sample from. Now you need to see that whether the, for example, sardine from one place is different population from the other place, that time genomics is helping. Where you are totally blinded, you don't know what kind of sample you can expect from your water sample, and it has its own advantages as well, especially for the biodiversity mapping. Seasonally, if you keep on sampling the water at one particular place, then you can see the presence or absence of particular species. For example, you are interested in studying one coral reef and what kind of fishes are there. So whole coral reef, you might not be able to always dive and go through noting the species. But when you collect the water sample seasonally, and then you can see that in a particular season, some species are present, and other season that is not present at all. So you can see that those are the migratory species which visit the coral reef in a particular season only. So that is the benefit of meta barcoding or metagenomics. And that's where, again, you can do this approach in two ways. For example, you want to only focus for a species in question, that, okay, I want to see the presence or absence of a species of my interest. So the water sample and the pool of the mixed DNA, you may not want to focus for all the types of strand. You want to just match whether, for example, if I'm again interested in a sardine, so if the sardine matching is happening in this sample or not. So sardine library I have, and I want to just study the presence or absence in a particular sample. So this could be specially, for example, that an island chain, northern end if the sample is taken, and southern end also sample is taken. One sample I may get sardine positive, another I may get sardine negative. So that way I come to know that extent of the population habitat, and seasonality also, that whether the like same situation prevails for all the months or not. So this kind of presence absence analysis is very useful, even if you are targeting one species. If you are more open-minded, you want to just measure the biodiversity, then you may have the wider library to compare with, and then you can complement your observations along with the other approaches. For example, diving and video recording. So the species that you don't have in your library, that also you can then see that, okay, new sequences are there. So some of the samples that you can get from the, say, fishing, and then you can actually develop library with the help of barcoding, and then you can use that for the meta barcoding whenever you want to do presence absence analysis. So with that, now this science has reached, and what is there in the future? So as a fishery oceanographer, you might be doing this manually for next few decades, but not forever. Why? Because autonomous underwater vehicles are already there, even though in prototypes or in the very advanced, just early stages, not very widely used or being produced. But the gliders or AUVs are already there, existing, which collects limited number of samples for the EDN analysis also. So in future, you can say that further miniaturization of the sensors and further you know, accommodation of more samples happen, these kind of autonomous vehicles will keep on collecting eDNA samples throughout the oceans. So with this particular session post, which I will then go through. Okay, is there tagging tuna? There is a question. Is there tagging tuna caught in purse seiners in practice, apart from tuna caught by hooks? So as of in our experience, the tunas that were caught, it was all by hooks. So I'm not sure about purse seiners, but it might have happened elsewhere in the world, and I might not be aware about. Is there any negative impact of tags on the tagged fish or animals? Should I switch back to the a video, or it is fine with the slide? Because I don't see any questions that is pertaining to this slide. So I'll just go back to the video mode as of now. And if any question pertaining to showing particular slide, I will again switch back to that slide as well. So I hope I'm visible now. So the question is there any negative impact of tags on the tagged fish or animals? If available, how to minimize the impact? So you need to make sure basically that how you are tagging the animal. So like I have shown in the one of the slide, you might want to practice with the dead specimen that you have already. So if it is a fishery resource, you may have the fish caught and available in the harbor. So you may have to do this kind of enough practice so that when you actually do the tagging in the middle of the sea, and where it is not very stable like shore or land, and there also you will be able to perform this without harming the animal and within few tens of seconds. So that is one way to minimize, knowing which kind of teethers are there, where to tag, which location, to ensure that fish does not develop any infection. All those are the also other precautions that you can take, because as a researcher, and these tags are very costly, so it starts from a few hundreds of the US dollars to up to few thousands of the US dollars per piece. So as a researcher, when you put this kind of tag on an animal, you also have the financial selfishness that the tag should collect as much as data possible, and animal should not die because of we could not take the proper precaution. So that is where to minimize the impact. So third question was, fish tags are expensive. Expensive is a relative term, so depends on what budgets that you have. But I told the approximate price range of the satellite tags, and those are the costly ones. Acoustic tags are tags themselves might be cheaper, but you don't forget the part that you also have to set up the hydrophone or receiver array, so that separately costs. So that is also having its own costs. Can we use tuna tagging study to study on thermocline depth? Definitely, when tuna is diving, it is diving below thermocline depth, then you can record warmer temperature and below thermocline colder temperatures. So tuna will definitely collect both types of data. There is no off switch on that, so data will be keep on collecting. So if that is the question, that whether the tunas will collect the thermocline data, if you have the profile data when tuna was diving below thermocline, you can actually get thermocline information as well. Are there a particular fish, a type of fish used for this operation? Which operation? You need to be considered in choosing the fish. I don't understand the question. Which operation? So tagging operations are based on the species in question. You want to decide which kind of tags you want to use. Smaller ones may be expensive and may not have that many sensors like the bigger ones, and battery life smaller, everything like that as well. So you may want to choose wisely which kind of tags you want to put based on the species in question. So definitely the tags that is being put on tuna are different than the tags that is being put on smaller fish. So that is, if that was the question. For fish DNA barcoding, name the gene used for sequencing. So it is not the gene, but basically the particular location based on the particular species, which is the unique location. There are abundant papers available for that, but we are not touching that down at that kind of advanced level. And we will be covering that in the advanced course. So which kind of regions of the genome are targeted for a particular species. So if you are interested, papers are available, you can search that. But otherwise, you can, if you are interested in learning, then you can attend the advanced level of this particular course, where we will touch upon those points. Can you tell the database for comparing the barcoding data? So definitely, yeah. So there are a open source database available, and many laboratories across the world, in Japan or in US also, they're developing their own libraries, surveys for quantification. So as of now, it is the science that we can say it is in infancy, but definitely research is on for converting these eDNA signal for estimation for the quantification. So in coming decades, that also will become a reality. So how fish or animal tagging can be used as a conservation strategy? So for example, if you have a species that you want to conserve, you need to know its habitat usage. If you know the habitat usage, then you can see that what other maritime usage, for example, the how much of the habitat it is actually covering of the shipping lanes, and whether the shipping lanes are very crucial, it cannot be moved at other place, what other practices are there, whether these are the prominent fishing grounds or fishing grounds are not that prominent, and the areas can be called for the fishing closure forever, and then you can declare that as a MPA. So these are the understanding that you can generate by tagging and recording the movement of the fish or this species that you want to conserve. So first is the habitat usage, then understanding its environmental preferences, then you can understand that with the seasonality how the environment will also shift the habitat. So now the where more and more researchers are conveying that habitats are not something a static thing, but it could be a flexible based on the season, and with the backdrop of climate change, we need to see that how habitat will shift and should address that. So I hope that answers the question. And in our developing countries, how can we use these approaches to better protect our resources? So these are the priorities that basically the funding agencies and governments will decide. The idea here to introduce you to, and I understand that majority of the student pool, it is from the developing countries, and then better understanding of these technologies will make in future you the better advocate for these kind of approaches. So you can always go for global funding that is available if there is a limitation of the fund, or you can convince the policymakers to understand the importance of these kind of approaches and to implement that as a part of regular standard operating procedures for the resource management. So that is how you can do that. So advocacy is one of the important thing. And if the water is very turbid, the penetration of light will affect the sunrise sunset reading. Yes, it will affect. The penetration of light will affect the sunrise sunset reading. Yes, it will affect. Is there any solution to those kind of issues? So as of now, the only solution is that not many of the this kind of light sensors are being used for tagging these species which are residing in the coastal waters. So if you are focusing for the oceanic species, then you will face this kind of errors very less. Some species natively they are not living in the pelagic region. So in those regions where you can say dysphotic or aphotic zones, if these species are residing, then another approach is based on the using the earth magnetic field. So you have the magnetometer on tag, some kind of tag variants are available for that. So it will make use of the reference of as a Earth magnetic field, and it will try to determine the anomalies in the magnetic field as a proxy for location and try to understand the underwater tracking. So that is another experiment done on Hilsa fishes. Are they migratory? As they are migratory fishes, it is believed that due to the construction of Farakka barrage, Hilsa change its migration path. So yeah, tagging experiments, efforts have been done, even though not that many, but yeah, efforts were done. And since you know that Hilsa is a sensitive species, so there was very high mortality rate, and the taggings were earlier, it was not successful. And we hope that in future, with miniature tags and better handling practices, there we could tag Hilsa, you know, successfully. And then in future, we will get this kind of data also from tagging Hilsa. What are the important species of interest which can't be studied with tagging? So, for example, smaller fish. There are limitations in they're taking long migrations. You can't tag. Juveniles of major pelagics also you can't tag as of now, because if, for example, tuna at the juvenile stage you can't tag. So what is the juvenile stage of the life cycle movement or environmental preferences? It is yet to be studied with the help of tagging. That answers your question. Is it possible, the same question, that possible to tag every species of interest? Obviously not. So yeah, there are some limitations in that. Can eDNA be used to model trophic diversity as a particular area? Definitely, because basically if you have the sufficient libraries built up and you are doing the, like, you know, regular sampling, then you can identify many species with that. And as of now, the score of species that can be detected through eDNA route actually lies in many of the tens, rather in hundreds. So hundreds of species as of now, I can say, that can be resolved with the help of eDNA approach. So with that, you want to develop the community structure, you can do that. Like I said, quantification is still a tough nut to crack. So it is not actually built a trophic model as of now, but you can definitely assess, you know, qualitatively, trophic diversity and its seasonality with eDNA. So answer in general, it is yes. And I think that is the end of the questions. All right, so anyway, like every day, again, I can say that the last slide had my email ID, and on the description of this video also, my email